In a move that sent shockwaves through military circles and beyond, the United States Air Force dropped a bombshell in May 2021. The F-22 Raptor, hailed as the zenith of jet fighter technology, was earmarked for an early retirement. Despite its unparalleled dominance in the skies, plans were set to phase out the Raptor by 2030, with an immediate proposal to retire 33 of these aerial titans. This decision, met with disbelief and a stern rebuke from Congress, begs a burning question: why sideline the world's supreme fighter jet, a marvel that's yet to reach the midpoint of its operational life, especially when its predecessors, the F-15 and F-16, boast half a century of service? Unraveling this puzzle takes us on a journey through the tumultuous saga of the F-22's development and into the horizon of what lies beyond in the realm of aerial combat. What led to this dramatic turn? What comes next that's so advanced it makes retiring the F-22 seem like a good idea? Let's find out. The journey of the F-22 began in 1981 with the ambitious sketches of the Advanced Tactical Fighter Program. At the time, the F-15 Eagle was the pinnacle of American air superiority, outclassing anything the Soviet Union had in the skies. Yet the US Air Force was already envisioning its successor, a fighter jet that would not only maintain but extend American dominance in the air. This was no small feat, considering the Soviet Union and its allies outnumbered the US in terms of aircraft. The vision was clear: create a fighter jet that was stealthier, more agile, and faster than the F-15, one that could soar at supersonic speeds without the gas-guzzling afterburners. This new warrior of the skies would need to execute precision takeoffs and landings from shorter runways, boasting avionics so advanced they could blind the enemy's eyes and ears. The goal was to craft a jet capable of penetrating enemy defenses with the stealth of a shadow, striking critical targets and enemy fighters before they knew what hit them. It was a strategy inspired by Israel's stunning success in Operation Focus during the Six-Day War, where their air campaign's decisive victory showcased the strategic value of air superiority. In the event of a direct confrontation, this next-generation fighter would prove its worth in gold, outmatching multiple enemy planes in a dance of death. With grand plans to acquire 750 of these Titans for an estimated $64.3 billion in 1981 dollars, a figure that skyrockets to nearly $220 billion today, the Air Force set the stage for a new era. The competition was fierce, but Lockheed Martin's YF-22 design triumphed over the formidable YF-23, a collaboration between McDonnell Douglas and Northrop Grumman. However, the combination of international developments and program difficulties conspired to thwart the Air Force's original plan. The Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, and with the end of the Cold War and the start of America's period of undisputed international hegemony, there was much less of a need to spend so much money on a next-generation fighter. In 1999, the Air Force's proposed purchase order had dropped to 341, with a cost just shy of $200 million per plane by the time the Raptor deliveries ended in 2012. The final number was set at 187 production aircraft plus 9 test planes. Of these, only 150 are considered fit for combat. This number was adequate for the time, with America's international dominance still near its height and the only threats on the horizon being the low-level ones seen in the War on Terror. Even so, as the Raptor's production was being cut, there were voices warning of China's growing military might and the possibility of a resurgent Russia. They urged the Air Force to reverse course and acquire more F-22s. This was not to be, and there were too few Raptors on hand to replace the F-15 and F-16 fighters in the USAF fleet as the service had originally intended. Unfortunately, the voices warning in the 1990s and 2000s of a resurgent Russia and more aggressive China have proven to be right, and now the United States lacks the aerial dominance that the bigger Raptor fleet would have given it. To make up for the lack of numbers, the Air Force operates the Rapid Raptor program, which readies the F-22 to be surged to strategic hotspots that might require its presence. Under this program, at least 4 Raptors will be ready to go in response to emergencies anywhere in the world, with the appropriate crew, transport craft, fuel, and weapons needed to support them. Tellingly, the Air Force's Pacific Command was the original creator of the Rapid Raptor program, but it's since been expanded worldwide. As well planned as the Rapid Raptor program is, it still reveals the lack of F-22s available in the event of a full confrontation. 4 additional F-22s, as good as they are, would likely not be decisive in tipping the balance of a full-scale invasion of Taiwan, for example. To add to the problem of limited numbers, the F-22 is also a very expensive aircraft to operate, with a cost of over $85,000 per flight hour. This high cost is related to the need to maintain Raptor's stealth qualities and its F-119 engines. In contrast, the F-35's cost per flight hour is slightly less than half of the Raptor's, at about $42,000. Meanwhile, the F-16 costs about $27,000 per flight hour. To make matters worse for the Raptor's economics, the United States Congress banned all sales of the F-22 to foreign countries in 1997 in a bid to protect its technological edge. To this day, the United States is secretive about the plane and takes extra precautions when it operates even with its closest allies. The potential for export is one of the most important ways to pay for a weapons program. It's one of the reasons why the F-35 is much more economical than the F-22, despite also suffering for years in developmental hell and having high acquisition and flight hour costs. Because of international sales, F-35 prices have dropped over time, from $89 million per unit in Lot 11 to about $78 million in Lot 14, although they have since risen again. In contrast, the United States shouldered the entire burden of developing and manufacturing the F-22, and the order was for so few aircraft that costs remained high and there was a lack of spare parts. The F-22 is also not without its problems. Since it began its life in the early 1980s, it's beginning to show signs of being middle-aged. The F-22's timing was off in another way. In the 1990s, the US military began to understand that the pace of technological development would accelerate. New weapons designs therefore needed to be based on open architecture to allow for rapid upgrades of software and components, rather than creating an entirely new platform to accommodate the change in technology. The F-22 was not designed for such adaptability, and by the time the Air Force came to realize this increasing pace of technological development, the program was too late in its development to change. While the Raptor has gotten and is getting its fair share of upgrades, they are much more difficult and expensive in contrast to the F-35, thanks to the latter's open architecture design. Another of the biggest challenges for the F-22 is in sharing its data. Its computer systems cannot communicate directly with the F-35, for example. To do so, the Raptor often needs to translate its older programming language through U-2 surveillance aircraft. This arrangement is obviously less than optimal. The F-22 also needs better resistance to modern electronic warfare and better sensors to more reliably detect lower observable aircraft like China's J-20. The F-22's engines are also an issue. Although they are remarkable powerhouses capable of generating 35,000 pounds of thrust for a combined total of 70,000 pounds, this power limits the Raptor's range. The F-22 can fly for distances of about 1,850 miles, but this is only in its ferry range, with the addition of two external fuel tanks beneath its wings. These external tanks, however, make the Raptor much more visible to radar, and even when they are dropped, the pylons they were attached to still have a negative effect on its stealth profile. With all of this in mind, the Raptor's effective combat range is much more limited. By comparison, the F-15 Eagle has a range of 3,450 miles with its fuel tanks. The Raptor's range could be sacrificed in a war over the crowded continent of Europe, but the Raptor is less than ideal in a confrontation over the much greater distances in the Indo-Pacific region, where an aggressive China occupies the first place in Washington's foreign policy priorities. The F-22 is being upgraded to cover for many of these disadvantages, but the upgrades are expensive and difficult. We will have more on the specifics of these upgrades before the end of the video. The final nail in the coffin for the Raptor's viability is that it's almost impossible to manufacture any more of them. With a limited fleet and no foreign sales, the infrastructure and human capital needed to build the plane was allowed to atrophy. The tools and expertise that could be reused were shifted to the F-35 program. For example, the Raptor's radar-absorbent coating is different from the F-35's. Making more of it, with the necessary modern upgrades, would be prohibitively expensive. All told, restarting Raptor production would take years and tens of millions of dollars invested. Newly built F-22s would cost between $206 and $216 million each, on top of the millions it would take to recreate the necessary manufacturing capacity. With these factors in mind, perhaps it should not be surprising that the Air Force began to look ahead of the F-22. It simply made more sense to build a new aircraft, one that would be more economical, better designed, and more adaptable to handle present and future challenges. Enter the Next Generation Air Dominance (NGAD) program. The NGAD will be America's first sixth-generation jet fighter. As the F-22 set the benchmark for the fifth generation, its successor will be doing the same for the sixth. Sixth generation aircraft will, above all, be smart planes, fully integrated into the information warfare network with the assistance of artificial intelligence to help pilots prioritize the increasing amounts of information presented to them. These fighters would also have adaptive engines to make more efficient use of fuel, which would give them longer range without refueling. They would also carry higher payloads than fifth generation fighters, while maintaining their stealth profiles, fly with drone wingmen, and can also be operated as drones themselves. Like the F-35, the NGAD will be designed around open architecture, meaning that it will avoid the modernization problems that make maintaining the F-22 so expensive. Although the cost per plane is likely to be $300 million apiece, the Air Force plans on purchasing at least 200 to 250 of them, and 1,000 of its associated drones. There may be additional tranches following the initial purchases. Although this price tag sounds crippling, buying the NGAD in bulk will drive down the aircraft's manufacturing costs and ensure an availability of spare parts to better maintain the fleet. These factors will make the NGAD less expensive to operate than the F-22 in the long run. One prototype NGAD design had its maiden flight in 2020. Lockheed Martin and Boeing are the two main competitors, with the winner to be announced later this year. At that time, we may get to see the design of the aircraft. The speculation is that the NGAD will look a little like the B-2 and B-21 bombers, lacking any vertical structures like the F-22 and F-35's tail fins. Although designers have worked around these structures, they produce a significant radar return by their nature. The lack of these structures suggests the NGAD will be going all in on long range and low visibility. In contrast, the F-22 was essentially designed to be a stealth dogfighter. The NGAD's design is going to be a very big problem for Russia and China. These two countries, China especially, rely on anti-access area denial strategies to make up for the disadvantage they would still be in during a full confrontation with the US military. Sophisticated air defense networks and missiles that can defeat America's stealth fighters are a priority for Moscow and Beijing. There's no indication that these systems, like Russia's S-400, can reliably shoot down stealth fighters yet, but there is no doubt that in the future, the biggest threat to the F-22 will likely not come from enemy aircraft, but from surface-to-air missiles. The NGAD will be designed to defeat such a threat, and in this regard, it's part of the Pentagon's third offset strategy, which was envisioned in 2015 to counter peer or near-peer adversaries using A2AD strategies. In contrast to the NGAD, designed to counter the modern threat environment, the war the F-22 was designed for never came. Tellingly, its first air-to-air kill came in the Chinese spy balloon incident of early 2023, when a Raptor shot the offending target down near the coast of South Carolina. The NGAD's purported design suggests that it won't be as maneuverable as the F-22, but for a modern air battle, maneuverability is increasingly irrelevant. Most targets will be shot at from beyond visual range. Stealth, informational superiority, and the ability to strike at long range will increasingly be the most important part of air warfare. The Air Force is incorporating this idea into the heart of the NGAD, and although this conclusion once proved disastrous over the skies of Vietnam, it's more arguable that the idea back then was too far ahead of its time. Now, with much more sophisticated radar and longer-range, smarter missiles, the time has come. With these threats and technological realities in mind, the Air Force has concluded that in the long term, keeping a very costly platform like the F-22 Raptor around, one not as well adapted for a changing environment and which cannot be rapidly upgraded, is not in America's best interests. It would rather be a less than optimal investment compared to resources that could better be spent elsewhere. In this regard, Russia and China would likely be happier to see America continue to spend mountains of dollars on the F-22 rather than going all in on the NGAD. In its budget request for 2024, the Air Force proposed retiring its first Raptors. These are the 32 Block 20 F-22s that are considered non-combat coded. Instead, these aircraft have been used for training. The Air Force does not want to modernize these planes because it claims doing so would be too expensive. It instead argues that those resources would be put to better use on the NGAD. Congress has denied this request and has protected the Block 20 Raptors through at least fiscal year 2026. Possibly in response to such protections, the Air Force claims that the newer, combat-capable Raptors will remain its highest priority in the short term, and it will continue to upgrade them accordingly. Such upgrades include the use of the new AIM-260 JATAM, which will replace the AIM-120 AMRAAM as the Air Force's air-to-air missile of choice before the end of the decade. Although its exact details are classified, the JATAM was designed to counter the range advantage China's PL-15 missile has against the AMRAAM. This would put the JATAM's range in excess of 120 miles. Other upgrades likely include longer ranges and better sensors. Official Air Force renderings and recent photographs showed the upgraded F-22s featuring new external fuel tanks that would not compromise the plane's stealth profile. The new tanks are the product of the low-drag tank and pylon program. While these external fuel tanks are stealthy, unlike their predecessors, they also have a design advantage in that when they are dropped, they drop the pylon with them, keeping the Raptor's stealth profile fully intact if it needs to enter combat. These fuel tanks will likely prove useful for the F-35 and the NGAD as well. The official renderings also show external sensor pods to improve the Raptor's situational awareness through infrared search and track targeting, IRST. This feature permits the pilot of a fighter aircraft to target the heat signature of an enemy aircraft independent of radar targeting. The F-22 ended its production run too quickly to add this feature, but it's present in the F-35 and, more importantly, China's J-20 and Russia's Su-57. These systems are one way to detect the presence of stealth aircraft. Good engineering can mean less radar visibility, but every aircraft will emit a significant amount of infrared radiation, and the range of these IRST systems is increasing. The F-22 finally getting an IRST was necessary to ensure it remains the undisputed master of the air. Reportedly, the aircraft can travel at Mach 1.2 with both of these external attachments. The F-22's latest slew of upgrades will also make it more resilient against modern electronic warfare like spoofing and jamming. The Raptor's situational awareness will also improve because electro-optical targeting systems will feed data into the pilot's helmet. Surprisingly, F-22 pilots have had to navigate the dashboard and turn their planes toward their targets to get a shot. This archaic feature shows the age of the Raptor program overall, but soon, Raptor pilots will be able to target enemy aircraft just by looking at them, much like their comrades flying in the F-35. These upgrades will be welcome, because even if the NGAD is operational by 2030, it will take some time for the new fighter to be manufactured in sufficient numbers. With Russia gaining momentum in Ukraine and China making overtures of having the capability to successfully invade Taiwan by 2027, the Air Force cannot yet afford to give up the superiority capability that the F-22 brings to the table. But these upgrades, while ensuring the F-22 will remain the most dominant fighter in the world until the NGAD arrives, also betray the reasons why the Air Force is so set on retiring the Raptor fleet early. The upgrades will cost at least $9 billion through 2030, and that number came on the assumption that the Block 20 F-22s would be retired, which so far they have not been. By that math, upgrading each individual plane would cost something in the neighborhood of the price of a new F-35. Given the Raptor's other drawbacks, this is simply not viable as a long-term investment. The F-22 Raptor remains the world's best fighter jet, for now. Its ability to combine stealth and long-range hit-to-kill ability with traditional dogfighting attributes like speed and maneuverability is unparalleled, and might even exceed the NGAD. However, modern contested airspace increasingly has no need for such capability. With this reality and the F-22's prohibitive costs, it should not be surprising that the Air Force does not have long-term plans for it. By the middle of the century, the Air Force plans to field only 4 aircraft in its fighter fleet, down from the current 7. These 4 will be the NGAD, the F-35A, the F-15EX, and the latest version of the F-16. There is no room for the F-22 in these plans once the NGAD is ready. That's a good thing. What do you think about the Air Force's plans to begin retiring the Raptor? Is the brass making a mistake, and will Congress further intervene to save the F-22? Don't forget to let us know in the comments. Also, make sure to hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more military analysis from military experts. Now go and check out why the USA never sold the F-22 Raptor to other countries, or click this other video instead.